Electronic Arts. As I'm sure you're aware of, in one way or another, this company. It was founded way back in 1982, making it just a little older than myself, and is headquartered in Redwood City in Northern California. They develop, deliver, and deliver games, content, online services for internet-connected consoles, as well as mobile devices and personal computers. Through their cutting-edge games, innovative services, powerful technologies, they bring worlds of infinite possibilities to nearly 600 million active players around the globe and are dedicated to creating new, innovative, and immersive gameplay experiences. Committed to building exceptional games, EA Studios is made up of over 20 studios and have more than 6,000 creators globally. They're responsible for some of the world's most beloved game franchises, including EA Sports, FIFA, Battlefield, Apex Legends, The Sims, Madden NFL, Need for Speed, Titanfall, Plants and Zombies, as well as many others, and are staples of and within the global gaming community. They're one of the leading gaming companies worldwide with an incredible market cap of over $35 billion, net revenue of over $7 billion, and that's US in 2023 alone. To help illustrate this, here's a short little 2-minute highlight reel from Capture Lab showcasing just some of what they do.
Adam, is the Capture Lab slide up? We're still seeing the main slide.
Next up.
Okay.
Good.
Yep, we're still seeing the main slide. We're still seeing the animation mastery from pixels to motion slide.
Interesting. Okay. I have shared my screen. I am moving it along. Just bear with me one second here.
You can try resharing.
Yeah, I think I'm going to have to unshare and share. Just one second.
No problem.
That's interesting.
Want to miss all the good stuff.
I know, right? Okay.
There we go. We got it.
Is that okay? So there we go. Electronic Arts, a few little stats about those that have covered. And then this has moved along with me now.
Now we're cooking.
We're on the video screen. Awesome. Okay. Thank you, Jared. Thank you. And with that, I will turn it over to you, Derek. Welcome, and once again, thank you for joining today's speaker series.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me. Do you want me to give a little background of myself first? A little intro?
That'd be great. That'd be okay. Awesome.
So I initially got a degree in a Bachelor of Science in microbiology. And then in my province, I grew up in Manitoba, they had a school for the first time doing computer animation. And at the time, Jurassic Park just came out, Toy Story just came out, and it was very, very popular. I always loved drawing and cartoons. And so when those movies came out, it really piqued my interest into looking at a different career path. And so I got accepted into that school, and I knew I had to move east, west, or south. And so I liked British Columbia. And so I moved out here, and I ended up getting a job in video games, which I wasn't even expecting in the beginning. I was looking for film or TV, for cartoons. And there was a lot of video game companies in Vancouver. So I applied for a couple, and I couldn't believe that people were getting paid to do these jobs. So it was a big eye opener for me. Back in, that was 2001. It's cool that now that there's so much exposure for it, but for me it wasn't. So it wasn't really something I was looking for. But yeah, I've been at EA ever since 2001. So I can talk about QA and career progression later.
Okay. I think Jared, maybe I'll turn it over to you first, Jared. I'm sure you do. I know I have all kinds of questions for Derek. I'll let you pick his brain first though, Jared. Maybe dig into him working at EA and things like that.
Well, the mere fact that you have a very familiar story about the idea that you'll listen to, whether it's people in the media or just personal stories of folks finding their way into a career that they thought was like this true passion. They didn't know how to get into the industry, and then suddenly they get into the industry and they realize, you know, people are getting paid to do this. And that's certainly a familiar repeating story for folks that really enjoy what they do. And how you started out in QA, that's an interesting way to go about it, because one of the open avenues that a lot of people have when they first get into the industry is wondering, how do I get my foot in the door, even if I have an education, I just graduated, or I'm rated a high school and I have no post-secondary skills, but I want to advance on that. But in the meantime, I still want to get into the video game industry. QA, or quality assurance, where you're testing video games, is a mainstay for a lot of students and future professionals getting into the industry. What was your pathway to either finding QA and then getting out of QA into a position that you found yourself in as far as animation?
So because I had a technical background in sciences and testing, like creating experiments and hypotheses and testing it out, and then I also had an art background, it was back then pretty rare commodity, so it was very easy to transition into QA. And especially my role of art and animation is what I mostly tested. It was a great blend. And once you show proficiency in it, QA is a really good place to see a lot of different avenues. So I could see parts of building a game that I didn't even know existed. And so a lot of people go in there not with a technical or art background. They may have production, they may have film, they may be on sets, but you can really see a wide variety of doors that you could go through. And obviously, you don't go in there, spend a few months. Like, you do need to become proficient, and then you can, they want to make sure that you can do the job, basically.
How did you show off your skills to the point that testing turned into animation?
So a cool thing most companies will do is they don't want to lose talent. So if you want to do something else, they'll try to make sure that your current role is not left empty. And then give you opportunities to pursue other paths if they are available. And so I spent a couple of years. Initially, I was going to go into creating environments, working on textures, working on head scans. But then I saw, oh, there actually is a motion capture department that was booming at the time. So they're really like, oh, come and see what we do. And so I loved it. And so I applied, and, you know, it took a few months to transition, but yeah.
What's an example of for those that are kind of in attendance, is that idea of what's your day-to-day look like now as opposed to then?
So in QA is much different, but when I started in motion capture, there was a big group of animators manually doing data. Now that I've been there for a while and software, hardware is evolving, I'm more in a senior role. I will do R&D. I will do training. As compared to looking at game teams, I'll collaborate with them to meet expectations and timelines. And then when we actually get into the actual production, like, we shoot almost every day, but I'm not in production every day. We cycle games and locations. Then I'll QA data, process it, and, you know, oversee it.
How long are you normally on a game production?
So we shoot mocap, and we call it a shoot block. So it could be anywhere from like a day to 4 days, maybe 5 days. 5 days is a lot of work. There's usually setup, teardown, prep. But yeah, usually that game will shoot for a few days, and then you process it for a few days or a few weeks afterwards. It used to be, delivery times used to be anywhere from like 6 months, like 20 years ago. And now it's like, you could probably deliver in the next day or two. So you can see how technology and everything has advanced so much. But sure. Then they'll come back multiple times per year, per cycle. So, yeah, you're always leapfrogging. That's one thing I liked about mocap is you're not just doing the same thing every day. You are bouncing around and doing different things.
I remember those days. And also the idea of having software, even within VCAD, that's using software that's emulative of what you're using at EA, like my motion builder, you know, different techs like that. So it's like the idea of not being dissimilar from your everyday use of software versus, you know, students. You're basically using the same tools, only to a different proficiency level.
Yeah, for sure. It's the industry, especially motion capture, uses the same programs. There's going to be proprietary scripts and things to help automation, but the fundamentals are all the same.
Where do you kind of see your position going, or maybe even mocap going in the near future? Just because you've seen such a stark evolution of where capture data could be taking 6 months as opposed to a couple of days. Where do you kind of foresee the tech and the proficiency in video game production going, even in the short term?
Well, when I started, we were using ping pong balls, like one per joint. So it's evolved so much since then.
Like mocap suits.
Yeah. But now gamers and games are demanding more content. It's all, everything's scaling up and everything's getting hyper real. Not only characters, but backgrounds, audio, everything. So we need to adapt. The industry needs to adapt. So there's going to be new creative ways to get more content faster and higher quality. It sounds impossible, but there's new ways to capture things using volumetric. There's new programs coming out. There's new scripts coming out. So yeah, it's pushing for scale big time.
That's quite the dichotomy, where you're talking about a booming industry, yet they're saving time and producing more, and yet the demand for, you know, junior talent and even the senior talent is growing. So it's a real balancing act.
Yeah, and every tool evolves. You started doing manual, then you figure out how to do it at scale, then you figure out how to automate it, and then you go to the next thing. Awesome. Yeah, and because game content's getting so huge now, it's the demand is there.
Well, that's encouraging for everybody looking to get into the industry. Is there not? It's a booming industry, but the tools aren't reducing the work. They're just expanding the probability on.
We're trying to catch up. It's like a fire hose.
Well, that's encouraging. I don't want to monopolize too much time because I think Adam had some questions too.
I just want to follow up on that even a little more as far as the industry trends and where you've seen it come from all the way to here, where it is now. Can you maybe just elaborate on that a little bit more and speak to what you've experienced over the last few years while working at EA and where maybe you see it going?
Yeah, so I do work mostly in sports. And so I can talk with regards to motion capture video games with sports. Now there's trends for like you see a TikTok celebration or you'll see like a special goal being scored. Gamers want to do that the next day. They see it Sunday. They want to do it in game Monday. We used to spend like a year putting that stuff in game. Then we have DLC comes in every six months. Now we're seeing like a live service. And they want it like in a week. And that's hard. People think it's just like that's all we do. But we have a lot of things to do. And so that's where I see trends happening. That's just one example of scale and speed and quality. How do you get a Michael Jordan slam dunk or like a Tiger Woods golf swing? It's especially to a high fidelity. But we're getting there. We're getting tools. We're getting scripts. We're getting headcount to get that responsiveness, that quality, and that scale.
Wow, very cool. You mentioned to go in not necessarily needing like a full technical background, but just as far as skill sets. What kind of skill set might you see common across your fellow employees or coworkers at a place like Electronic Arts?
Well, I think there's two that I really have seen over the years that just become successful. One is like enthusiasm, like being passionate, being positive. You can learn tools and you can learn pipelines. You're going to be learning all the time, but it's really, you can't train like a good attitude. So, and another one is like a team player, which is kind of the same, like unless you're working in a silo by yourself, which most people aren't, being able to work well in a team or with others, it just makes you successful and it makes the project successful and it makes your company successful. So those are my, like, I work in a team and we would not survive without working well as a team. There's just so many ways to break down. And it's going to be stressful and there's always problems, but being able to have a positive attitude and be able to work as a team, you get through anything. So those are two key things I find that are very important.
Interesting. It makes a lot of sense, though. It really does. To sort of take it off in another direction a little bit, how do you feel the programs at VCAD may prepare graduates for the industry, not necessarily just for EA Games, but for that industry in general?
Using industry standard tools with industry focused exercises, I think is like the best way to prepare, because most companies will have proprietary tools and workflows and scripts. And a lot of that's learned on the job. Like, there's no need to learn that stuff until you get there. But the best way to prepare for that is to learn the fundamentals. Just learn your core skills that, you know, and then you can just step onto that to your specific job. Yeah. Another thing is also having a good visibility of other genres or other departments. Even if you're just texturing, it's good to know rigging, it's good to know lighting, it's good to know what the other chains are doing, because you never know where it's going to break before you or after you.
Yeah. So you're taking and absorbing all those little skill sets that you get from the programs.
Yeah.
Very neat. Okay, so I also don't want to take up too much time. I do want to leave ample amount of time for the audience to ask their own questions. So at this point, I'd like to turn it over to Jared to go through the VCAD program details, specifically for the game development and design and 3D modeling and animation, before we watch a demo reel video from a few of our graduates showing some of their portfolios and more. And then we'll open it up to questions from the audience from the chat. So you guys can have your questions ready and then start typing them into the chat, and we'll take them one by one. So back to you, Jared. We'll flip it over to our next slide here.
Sounds good. Actually, two slides.
Two slides. That's, there we go.
There we go. Yeah, speaking to that I, you know, Derek's point on there being a lot of the fundamentals that you'll learn at VCAD. That's exactly the right tone to strike, is when you're getting into the studios and you sit in front of the computer for the first time, whether it might be the same software, but you're dealing with expectations of production and tool sets, plugins, and workflows. You're looking at your surroundings and getting to know what the production needs are. I've always found that my education skyrocketed after college, because once you have those fundamentals and those essential skill sets in, like, really solid, then you get into the industry and you realize, quote unquote, how little you actually know, just because those fundamentals are just the foundation of everything that gets piled on afterwards. Typically, it's going to be specialization. So if you come into VCAD and you're learning the fundamentals, and then you exit with a wish to become an animator, but you have this whole background, it's like those expectations of production are what's going to drive your education in one specific area right up through the roof, which is exciting. But having those fundamental skills at the outset also enables you to look to see what, not only see what, but have an appreciation of those other aspects that Derek was talking about. So you get into a studio and you're sitting next to a rigger or, you know, an environmental designer and this type of thing, and all these different skill sets with those particular people having those particular passions in those particular positions in the pipeline of production, is, I always found that to be really exciting, because you're getting into the idea of getting to know every single aspect of the production, and you know where you fit. It's that idea of knowing where that project has come from, and now it's in front of you, and where it's going to go from you into the next department. And having some familiarity of that is very handy and gives you great optics as to the skill sets that other people possess. So with VCAD starting out, whether it's the 3D animation and modeling program or it's the game design development program, one skews more into the direction of some technical aspects and some creation on the design aspects for games. But both have a lot of shared elements that enable you to come in and learn the fundamentals that I always found VCAD had a lot of aspects that set itself apart from other colleges, just because the idea that I learned traditional animation and then I learned 3D afterwards, and I found my 3D skills were enhanced greatly by having a lot of experience in the traditional, you know, fundamentals. So color and design, life drawing, perspective, shading, you know, shape analysis, and this type of thing. All those elements that would go into term one, particularly for VCAD, it enables it to have students come in with the fundamental understanding of how you create with traditional viewpoints, and then you move steadily into more and more challenging realms of 3D. And that's using everything from industry standard software that Derek would use, like Motion Builder, Maya, Photoshop, and then you go into more specialized programs. Motion Builder would classify as like a specialized program specifically for motion capture, but since we have a motion capture course, we definitely made, I made sure that we were using the exact same tools that I would have been using and they still use at EA. So that idea of having been at EA for a long time and having had the opportunity to direct motion capture, take that motion capture data and manipulate it so that it's operating properly, that was only achievable through knowing what it is that you've got your hands on. So the actually, Adam, do you want to switch over to the game design development slide?
Yep.
This. There we go. So this one has a little some more technical aspects to it, where you're learning game animation as opposed to say film and television animation. You're looking at UI, UX design, the idea of game theory, gamification of things. There's all these avenues of thought that go into the creation of the design of different game elements, as opposed to say a film production or television or VR and this type of thing. So those elements are like beyond VCAD, but at the same time, the fundamental knowledge that you're going to gain through what we have available is really wide. So, but it's also really intense. So just like Derek would have experienced, or I did experience when you first get into the industry, it feels overwhelming, but you're all the more confident when you're prepared with the fundamentals. So that the courses that are offered, the programs that those courses are, you know, housed within, are very well thought out. And the nice part is they're always evolving, because like Derek mentioned, the industry is always changing. There's the software mainstays, which are great to have at VCAD, but at the same time, the contents of the programs, the makeup of the courses, those fundamentals, those methodologies, keeping your eye on the industries, plural, that's important. So that's an ever-evolving beast. The idea of making sure that programs and courses are always on a moving target, they're never stationary for that long, that just goes into establishing a strong fundamental base before you get into the industry. I think we've got, is it a slide we have next?
Video reel, demo reel. I think it is a video up next from some of the graduates, showcasing some of the graduates. So we'll flip over to that here.
Cool.
There we go.
Thanks, Adam. There's no sound or music to this, just because I wanted to talk over top of it. This is actually cleaned up motion capture data that was placed from a Unity engine and onto the character. So you clean up that data and you end up with characters that have predetermined motions with predetermined rigs that are placed in these different models. All the models were, in this particular instance, are created for Gatlin and for Michael. These are created custom for these level experiences they made, whereas Ryan had pulled his from the web, but still used motion capture data and then clean that up to show the process of how he was able to get it to that character to operate smoothly using messed up motion capture data on a model where the rig wasn't necessarily meant for it. So here you're dealing with created models and in-game assets that are pulled from pulled from the library, so that if you happen to not be as strong on the artistic side, but you still wanted to create something technically very proficient in as far as interactivity and player experience, then those assets are there. And the reverse happens. So if you happen to be a lot more artistic, but you don't have those technical aspects, then we have instructing staff, we have courses, we use the game engines that are current to have those predetermined pieces of information that you plug in. We've also had students in Gatlin's game and when Trevor's game, where they were teaming up. So they had more art and design and technical and more programming heavy specialities in students joining forces to create something. But at the same time, the students like Michael here that really wanted to keep everything self-contained to what his own creation and vision was, he had assets and time to use the game engines that we do use to create at least a demonstration. It doesn't have to be a whole game. Typically, you don't want even if you do develop a massive scope to a game, you're only going to need to present a small portion of it to show your artistic skills, your technical skills, to just whet the appetite through the use of a demo reel or a demonstration reel, so that those that are like recruiters and different professionals that are looking at your future graduated work from the program are going to get a sense for exactly what your skills are, in addition to what you would put on, say, a resume or on your LinkedIn, your future LinkedIn. But yeah, there's right now each one of these individuals are working. I think Ryan's working at Torn Banner Studios, Gatlin's working at Next Level Games, Michael's working at Keyword, Valentina, who is doing the Unreal demonstration, is working at Animatrix. And so there's lots of different scopes for the being on the West Coast. And like Derek said, it's like there's so many per capita in the general area. You're looking at so many visual effects, television, film studios, game studios in one area on right here in BC, particularly in Vancouver's hub, or the immediate surrounding area, that it offers VCAD the opportunity to have the graduates not have to travel out too far, whether it's it's games, film, or television, et cetera. So the idea of being on the West Coast is a real advantage to the college as far as situationally, as opposed to if it was, you know, in Australia or Brazil or even the East Coast. So yeah, that's a quick rundown.
So I guess all of that's pretty much from portfolio works. Is that right? Almost everything that we saw there?
It was all from demo reels from portfolio works.
Wonderful. So at this time, I think we're going to open it up to questions. I see everyone's kind of been typing them into the chat already, so we'll do our best to answer as many as we can here. First up, we have a question from Victor. What do you think about AI? Do you believe that it can help in the development of games by decreasing the production time?
We've been using AI and machine learning for decades. It's always been in games. It hasn't been in tools the whole time, but it's been in tools for decades as well. I view it as, I was talking about this earlier, about they wouldn't allow calculators 30 years ago in school, and now they use calculators. So AI is just going to be another calculator for us. They're always developing tools with machine learning and AI. And like I said, there's a demand for it. I don't think AI or machine learning is ever going to take over the quality part, like the human touch. But you want to get to the quality and character part of it faster. And right now, that's what it's going to help. It's going to help get that grind out. It's going to help get anything that you can just standardize out. So yeah, it's going to grow. So are the games, and then we can go do the stuff that humans do best instead of just grinding and fixing stuff. Yeah. Everybody, especially in animation, they want to get to that last 10% and noodle that character. Most of the time is just trying to make it look good, good enough.
Next up, we have one from Jeff, and I think Jared, I mean, I could touch on this, but I think Jared will turn it over to you for this one. I'm starting into the graphic art and design course as a starting point. Is that a decent idea for getting somewhere?
The graphic art and design program?
Yes.
I know I was chatting with a colleague not too long ago, is the idea that like things like Photoshop, Illustrator, these types of more graphic design elements are still embedded within the use of entertainment in general. So it doesn't necessarily have to be just print or this type of thing. It can be, there's a huge demand for motion graphics, and the essentials of motion graphics are jumping into elements of using Photoshop, using Illustrator, using After Effects and different avenues of creating visuals. So any opportunity you can have to develop your artistic skills and use software that's industry standard, it's going to lend to what you're seeing on screen, whether it's 2D animation, you're just learning your drawing skills, you're learning perspective, you're learning, you know, those fundamentals. It's like the graphic design program in itself is exceedingly popular, and it has a massive, you know, job base. But at the same time, it's elements of artistic throughput is the same as what you would expect someone to have when they're entering the industry, and they have all these aspects of learning the having known the software that's going to get them a leg up, and at the very least, it's going to teach you the fundamentals that would inform your future if you were to jump over to different programs within, like, the media program. So that's it's certainly not going to hurt your chances of having an established industry to go to afterwards, and a good jumping off point to understand the fundamentals that are going to inform your future programs.
Awesome. So the next one's kind of a three-part question, but they are all interrelated in some way or another. Do you have any tips and tricks on networking leading up to graduating? If a student wanted to work at your studio specifically, what could they do to stand out? I believe that may be networking related. And then upon graduation, what would you recommend moving to a hot zone such as Vancouver or look for remote work before making the move?
All right. So networking, LinkedIn is great. Finding groups that are doing the passion that you want to do, so that you can look on Facebook. You can go to companies and ask. We have, I believe we did interns for a few summers, maybe since the pandemic, it kind of changed, maybe more remote or whatever. One of the things working remotely does kind of make it more challenging, but I would say if you are passionate in animation, there's animation groups out there, there's animation nights, going to the companies and talking about what they have available. As for if you wanted to work at EA, EA is huge. They're always hiring in some capacity. I just seen today they're hiring animators for Maxis for The Sims. Every week there's new jobs coming up in different vocations, whether it's rigging, lighting, audio, animation, every week. So there's a website you can go to, EA specifically, and look at what's being offered this week. And there's always like 30, 40 jobs up there every week, and it's always changing. And for graduation, as we're standing out, for example, we have people come in for interviews, and it's a pretty long process, multiple interviews and multiple people asking you stuff. We had a guy come in. He did so much research and he was so passionate. He's asking everybody specific questions about their role and asking what he would be doing. And where a guy like that, he is a shoo-in. I mean, that guy sounded like he was already working there. I think doing your research and being passionate, it shows that you're serious about it. So that really helped. And for going to a hot zone. So if before the pandemic, I would have said for sure, especially animation, there's a lot of high tech industries, especially graphical wise, you needed to be there for the network access, for frame rates, for collaborating. I never ever worked a day from home until the pandemic. And I said, I'll never be able to do this. I need to get back in the office. And within a month, our IT had us set up working from home. And I would have bet money that it would never be possible. But now I work from home. And there's challenges with networking and communication, but there was when you were in the office anyways. So it's possible. So you don't need to move. I mean, the more hooks you put in the water, the higher chance you're going to catch fish. So, I mean, it doesn't hurt, but we work with a lot of people who are remote now. It doesn't matter where they are.
Very neat. To add on to that, I would just say that the something else as far as networking, if you're looking for networking, where LinkedIn and whatnot, all those avenues are terrific to get to know the recruiters within the studios. And then getting out to events, live events. Some of them there's obviously virtual components now to piggyback on what Derek was saying because of the pandemic. Some say Spark and festivals and stuff like that, they run regularly. They'll typically have job fair tack-ons. And getting out, whether it's to those events virtually or live, enables you to touch base with folks within the industry. And that's what those events are made for. So it's a good opportunity to look into your local or national opportunities for festivals, talks, seminars, SIGGRAPH style conventions. The list grows.
We have another three-part question here, the first part of which I touched on already just in my introductions. This time, I think I will let you speak for yourself and touch on a few on your own there, Derek. But what games have you worked on at EA Games? And then a lot of memes have said money is what gives EA the feeling of power. Is that true? And how well are you treated at EA, Derek?
Yeah, so in motion capture, we touch every game that needs motion capture each year. So it's a lot. And most companies, most game teams come to us. There's a few that for if they have specific needs or location, or maybe we're just too booked, there's instances where they don't come to us. But we get at least, I think, 24 SKUs every year coming to us every year. So I've worked on almost all of those if I'm too busy to work on one. So yeah, I you can see in the earlier video, I worked on Madden, FIFA, NBA, Tiger Woods, Battlefield. I helped Star Wars, like Respawn came to us 4 or 5 years ago. So we've been working with the Respawn games as well. Yeah, way back in the day, even like Lord of the Rings and Godfather. So yeah. Lots. And it's not like I worked on them for a year. I worked on them for maybe 2-3 months kind of thing. But you just leapfrogging from game to game to game. As for the memes, so EA is a publicly owned company, and that's, they want to make money. I guess they want to make money. That's all I'll say. I'm not the money guy. I'm an artist. So you'll see a lot of passionate people working in there. They're not all focusing on the dollar, they're focusing on making whatever they're doing really well. So I focus on doing motion capture. I don't have the decisions to make those money calls. As for am I treated well at EA? So EA, the industry in general, I won't say EA, but the industry in general, it was a young man's game 20 years ago. I was working 100-hour work weeks. It was passionate, but it was a young person's game. If you had kids or if you just had a life outside of work, it was tough. But in the last 10-15 years, EA wants to retain talent. They don't want burnout. They don't want you leaving. So they've been very inclusive, very diverse. They really respect time, especially working from home, working remotely. They're very empathetic to work-life balance and mental health. So They've done leaps and bounds specifically at EA in the last 5-10 years.
Awesome. Okay, so I am most worried about potential layoffs down the line, as the industry seems to be having a lot of ups and downs. Anything that you could help prepare someone with that?
Yeah, so enthusiasm, being a team player, they'll want to keep you. And another thing I was going to say, if I had to pick a third one, is adaptability. My role specifically in motion capture has changed significantly 3 times. And if you don't like it, you find something else. And if you like it, you roll with the punches and you change. And I like where I am. I like what I do. And if the job role changes, it's a choice, really. So being adaptable is really going to make you bulletproof.
Next question. Go ahead, Jake.
Oh, I was just going to say, to piggyback on that, is the idea that skills and software and the industry ups and downs, that obviously plays a role into governing where you're looking for work, how long contracts are, you know, where you have to travel to, et cetera. It can create a lot of inflexibility as far as you're wanting to just stay in a place and just, like, almost like Derek, like you spend your entire career at one location, which is very rare. But it's also an enormous company. So you just move from production to production, and it's like a small city in Burnaby, as opposed to a smaller, I know, a boutique game studio or a small television station, this type of thing, or a television effects station. The idea of networking comes back, you know, over and over again. I myself I've actually used my resume about maybe 2 or 3 times in my entire career. The rest of it has just been letting people know that I'm free, or making sure that you're taking off your headphones and you're talking to your instructing staff at VCAD. You're talking to your fellow students who will likely end up being some form of colleague one day, maybe in the same studio. So the idea of maintaining those relationships beyond those job fairs and whatnot, you'll be able to, you know, really expand your horizons and be able to feel a lot more comfortable with your position at that time, knowing that if the worst happens and you are subject to a layoff, or you're part of a company that's has these ups and downs, you can reach out to your networking group, your web of contacts, and start to let them know, you know, I have this thing coming up, or this just happened, and you keep those relationships. And the idea of projects and the latest and greatest video game, or the best, you know, the movie that's getting all the attention, eventually those gather dust, but the relationships that you make along the way are what's going to keep you the most passionate about the industry, because the projects come and go, the excitement is still there for the passion for the work, but there's nothing sweeter than going to work and working on a project with people you enjoy being around, and in a company that, like Derek says, respects, you know, everyone individually and as a group.
Now, the next question, I feel like both of you again may have some tidbits to add to an answer for this one. Mitchell is saying that he's still kind of undecided about portfolio direction. How would one transition from a certain pipeline into writing stories for games? So I guess that's kind of a two-parter. What direction to go with a portfolio, and then the transitioning from a certain pipeline into writing stories.
Sorry, the two areas of interest, as far as like, were you trying to choose between game writing, as far as the story writing, and another, what was the other section?
How would one certain pipeline into writing stories for games?
One of the things that, kind of speaking back to what Derek was saying, is just being flexible. So having an aim that you want to go for is may not be available at any one particular time, but you basically look at that as your goal. And then if you're choosing an entry point, whether it's QA, whether it's it happens to be animation, or it's general game design, it's level design, it's something that's going to get you into those positions where it's at least in the studio or in the realm of being able to present a demo reel, it's going to get you get that ball rolling within the industry. Then you start to target, once you're in there, then you can start to target those people that are in those positions, and you can start to chat with them about their journey to get to that point, or just making sure that you're keeping your ear to the ground about what's available within the industry as you continue learning. So the idea of having a portfolio that has a specific target to a specific job, nothing wrong with that at all. It's like, but making sure that you're very well aware of what sort of things that particular industry role demands that you present as evidence of a skill set. But if it, but also keeping options open for making sure that if there's other skill sets that you can easily see yourself doing that have a higher demand or a wider base of opportunities, that if you enjoy doing that, that could be a good entry point along the way as well, to focus on a portfolio one way or another. Just depends on where you're, how much you have as far as content that you feel confident in presenting, and who you're presenting that content to.
I think we have more questions in the chat at this point than we may be able to get to, so I'll try to rhyme through as many as we can here. Next up, how common or looked for is it to have people with both an athletic coaching and artistic background in animation and rigging professions?
For EA, we were sport. In 2001, when I went there, we were almost exclusively sports. We did like some Sledstorm and some Lord of the Rings, but a lot of people there were ex-athletes, or they were like a soccer super fan. And so we played all sports all day, at lunchtime, at breaks, after work, before work. We have gyms in there. So we had a lot of jocks and a lot of computer nerds there. It does help. I mean, if you're going to be making a soccer game, it's nice to know the rules of soccer and the motion of soccer. For example, I was big into UFC. I was big into tennis. So when UFC was, we were making UFC, we made a tennis game. it really helped me right out of the gate to know what to look for, to know what the process. So it does help. It depends on what you're actually working on.
Considering the growth in both demand and the growth in technology to make game creation easier and more accessible, do you see the job opportunities opening or becoming more scarce?
I can speak with regards to animation. My team's grown significantly in the last 4 or 5 years, and it's not like we have less games. We actually, I think, have less SKUs per year now than we did 4 or 5 years ago, but we have way more staff. And I think it's just a sign that scope, like there's just so much more needed to make games now. So we've grown.
And a lot more content with those games.
Yeah, it's all about content and speed and quality. It's all going, the bar is just being raised on all fronts.
And I've got to say, even when you're looking at like, you know, TV and film and games, they're all detonating just in a good way, in a good direction, just because of the amount of avenues for consumption. So whether it's streaming services as opposed to 1980s cable, where there's like three channels, now there's hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of them. So it's like the amount of content for the consoles, for the game production, the amount of studios that are opening, there's definitely strong evidence to what Derek's talking about. And when you're looking at the statistics for expectations of the growth for the games industry, it's only exponentially going up.
Oof, this one, you may be a little biased for Derek, but what's the most important part in game development? Motion capture, imagine to be a big aspect, but.
Yeah, well, I know my role, and I know nobody cares about animation until it looks bad. So I don't know what the most important thing in the game development, that people like it, make sure that the user experience is good, I guess. Part of that is having good animation. Part of it is having good AI, having good UI, not crashing. So
I think that aspect of the best amalgam of things is to have a good team lead and a good team, you know, scope as far as talents, personalities, and a clear, decisive aim towards what you want to go for. That's the butter zone for any kind of good production. It's going to be good from the experience of creating it to the content users.
One of the questions is kind of a good follow-up on that, actually. With advances in the technology, where do you predict motion capture industry specifically heading? Do you see the industry staying with camera-based capture systems or motion capture systems?
Hey, Thomas. It's always evolving. There's volumetric, there's inertial, there's move libraries. We're always exploring all avenues, and there's always going to be use cases for everything. Some things can get set up quick. Some things are more portable. Some things can do an hour-long capture. Some things can do 20-person capture. So it's evolving, and especially now with needing content or needing on location, like going to the Olympics and doing skateboarding, stuff like that. There's going to be an instance that almost everything's going to be better than something else. So that's one thing that in the past, you know, you can't just put your eggs in one basket. You gotta be adaptable, and we can't bring our mocap studio to a football stadium, but we can bring something else. So yeah, that's awesome. I've never personally used exoskeletons. I've used inertial. I like how cheap and fast some of those things are.
We have a recent trend of a combination of 2D and 3D combined type of style animation. Since it's become popular with the younger crowd, do you believe that trend will continue and make its way into mainstream media?
Yeah, for sure. It'll be cool to see live action with 2D, with 3D, and being interactive. Like with this VR and AR, it's movies and TV shows are going to be different in 10, 20 years. Never mind video games. They're going to be video games.
Yeah, video games.
Yep.
Oh, sorry. Go on. Yep. Keep going.
So with portfolios, Derek, Mike's asking best place to send your portfolios for employers to view. ArtStation, personal websites, doesn't matter. Any recommendations for people to send out their own portfolios to?
All those are good. I've seen all of those. Make sure your name's in it. Make sure if there's an easy place to contact you so they know who it is. And make sure it's easy to see and make sure they know who you are. I've seen all those. I normally see animation, so I want to see videos. People throw it on YouTube. People throw it on their personal sites. They're all fine as long as I can access them and I know who you are.
Yep. And make sure that you're making sure that your content is, one, it's not providing too much personal data onto it. These days it can be a little tricky. And making sure that your content is typically fairly short, making sure that it's consumable in a small amount of time. And if there's, and you always want to start off with your lead, your best pitch. So whatever, if you're, I've heard demo reels that they advise you putting something strong at the start, but then strong at the end. Ignore that. Put it all that good stuff right at the start and catch them. Your typical viewer, myself included, who did hundreds of, you know, I've viewed probably thousands, thousands of reels. If each reel is 5 minutes long, you're going to be there for 25 years. So you want to make sure that you're accounting for your viewer looking at your reel, no matter how good it is, about 10 to 15 seconds. And if you've captured them, they'll stick around for a little bit. But so hit them hard, hit them fast, hit them quick, and you'll be okay.
Yeah, totally.
We are sitting with over 10 questions still here. We're past our hour, guys. I'm just going to pick two more questions, and then we'll cut it off from there. So I guess next up, if we were to, just let me do a little bit of scrolling here. Is motion capture a separate program, or is it offered with the game program in 3D animation? I guess motion capture, interested in the technical interest because of availability. Yeah, motion capture included in the programs, Jared?
We use motion capture data right now within the game software, game engine software. Right now we have programs that are using Unreal and Unity. Both of them have mocap. We have a dedicated instructors that are going to have specializations within those. And right now we're using data content to put it onto, very similar to Ryan, Michael, and Valentina's work. It's like they're using motion capture data, learning how to integrate it, learning how to clean it up, and then use it within their productions.
Awesome. And last up, will it matter what 3D programs you put into your resume or portfolio? I know Maya is the industry pipeline, kind of industry standard, but what about Blender? Will it be more biased towards either Maya or Blender? And then is Titanfall 3 real? I know you probably can't touch on those sorts of things, but that's kind of a two-parter, I guess.
Well, as far as Maya versus Blender, Blender is obviously, you can download it at home. It's free to use. It's open source. There's not a wealth of productions that have it within their studio for full production, but Maya is still far and away the industry standard. But at the same time, when you're talking about actual content creation for, say, a demo reel, it makes no difference whether you're using, software from 15 years ago or 20 years ago or something that's super current. If you show me a demo reel that has those elements that shows a learned level of expertise in the fundamentals that are going to be attractive to the studios that you're presenting to, that's what's most important. It's skills over software. So if you can show those skill sets and go into a program that's going to sit you in front of professionals like Derek and other folks that are working in the industry, and they can provide not only the advertised skill sets that you need to get to know the software, but be a connection to the industry. It's just going to give you that extra leg up that you wouldn't have had if you had just stayed home and learned from open source software on your own.
Titanfall 3? Yeah. Nope. You can just say you're not going to speak to it. That's fine. No problem. No dice. Can't speak to it. Sorry.
That's something you got to get used to in the industry is the non-disclosure agreement, the NDA. Yep. It's part of every contract that every professional has to sign. And the idea of signing up all those is lethally important within the industry. So knowing how to keep a secret is very important.
So you keep your job. You got to know the core. Yeah, I'll just say you got to know the core fundamentals, and you can learn any other button presses and other programs. There's lots of them out there.
Absolutely, it's like learning how to drive a car. As soon as you drive this car and it has a steering wheel, gas, brake, shifter, radio, windows, it's got the basics. If you learn in one car, you can sit in another car and generally know how to operate it. So it takes everything's in a slightly different position and whatnot. But the bells and whistles, this one has more bells and whistles, but generally a car is a car is a car is a car. So the idea of learning those software tools, Maya is extremely expansive program. But if your idea of learning the fundamentals is there and you want that specialization to move into animation, then animating in a proprietary piece of software that only EA uses is easy for you if you've already learned on Maya in an environment that's going to challenge you like a college, but then sit you in front of a piece of software that you haven't used before, but that's okay. Every studio also, in my experience, will provide any new recruit the idea of having a week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, a month, maybe a little bit more to get to know how the studio works, get to know the software that they've been using, but you have that leg up by already having the fundamentals learned.
Yeah, there's onboarding for even staff who are here if you're learning something new.
There you go.
I do apologize. That is all the time we have for questions from the audience for today. Thank you again to both Jared and Derek for being with us and your wonderful insights and answers to all the questions you were able to cover. For everyone in attendance, if you do wish to get started on your career path with VCAD, or simply you want to get to know a little bit more about the college or what the process of enrollment would look like for you. We do have scholarships that are available right now for our upcoming start dates in January and February for game development and design program, the 3D modeling art and animation program, between $2,000 and $3,000. One of my admissions advisors would be very happy to answer any and all questions you may have. Just drop your name and either a phone number or an email into the chat, and we'll make sure you guys are reached out to and have someone with all the information you require. Just a reminder, we do have our upcoming next industry speaker series. And we will be discussing, let me just flip over to the next slide. There we go. We will be discussing Hager Design International, featuring wonderful Candace Logan, who is a senior manager at the Hager Design International Studio. That'll happen next month, January 10th, 3 to 4 p.m. And that is it. That is all.
Thanks. I got one more point of order. This is going to be recorded and posted on the YouTube site, right?
Yes. Yep.
Yes. Okay. So those that missed it and they still want to this session, they still want to watch it. That's where to go.
And I believe some people came in late. So if you want to catch up on what you missed out on in the beginning stages, feel free. That'll be there again.
And thanks a big again. Special thanks to Derek for coming in.
Exactly. My pleasure. That's it. Very much appreciated, Derek. Thank you. And thanks.
Yeah, thank you.
Thanks both.
And thanks to everybody for all those in attendance. It's very nice of you to take the time to show up.
Thank you. That is it. That is all. Thanks for joining the speaker series today. Have a wonderful evening.